going down. I'm yelling timber, you better move.
The topic of the panel is, as you guys have read, is the cookie is crumbling. And I was actually on another panel discussion earlier this morning talking about the evolution of the cookie, or better expressed, the evolution of how to reach a consumer in a truly addressable fashion. That's what my esteemed panelists are here to discuss with us today. Before we dive into that, I'll allow the gentleman up here with me to introduce himself, starting at the end with Will.
I'm Will Hines. I work over at Hearts and Science. I do all things programmatic.
Jeff Liang. I work over at Assembly, leading up their digital practice there.
Hey, everybody. I'm Lou Pascal. I'm with Bank of America. I have three roles. I lead communication strategy, media investment, and then media measurement.
Tony Katzer, President, Sanobi. The reason we're moderating this panel is that this is a topic that's near and dear to not just my heart, but Sanobi's unique value proposition that we're trying to bring to market. So let's jump in here. So as consumers move to a world of the cookies, I think served us fairly well the past, 18 years, 15 years in the industry. That's worked well in the desktop environment, right? How do you find your customers across desktop? But clearly as the consumer hasn't fragmented, but the channels by which you can reach them has fragmented by orders of magnitude. And it's about to go through another evolution with things like connected televisions, the Internet of Things, myriad devices in the home. How do you guys, and Lou, we can start with you, like, how is Bank of America prepared to ensure that they're reaching the right people in essence, in those environments where the cookie doesn't exist? Yeah. So how are you guys trying to meet your customers and your prospects and where they're headed in a cookieless world?
Yeah, I think we're on a journey, and I think the journey started with the realization that we had probably a year and a half ago that there was all this noise in the system about how we adjudicate, people. And what we realized is that there was a simultaneous, and you use the word, evolution and revolution taking place. The evolution is that the probabilistic or aggregate model is getting a lot better. We have a lot more signal. We can append a lot more insight to that sort of aggregate view. But at the same time, the deterministic expectation, the one-to-one match, is what's going to win if we really understand how we're going to compete for attention moving forward, right? So we're in this, what I call the post-advertising era. And in the post-advertising era, we're in a desperate battle for relevance. To be more relevant, I need to leverage signal and be able to create more customized experiences, right? So to do that, if you think about it, I'm competing for attention now. This, to quote Rob Norman, we are at the end of the forced viewing economy, right? And when you really get that in your head, you realize that's the underpinning of advertising. So for us, it starts with harnessing the power of our first-party data, finding good partners who have great third-party data, and starting a journey which starts to take you into a realm that is a more CRM-like realm, where we're saying, okay, what is the combination of ad-like objects, content, experiences, and utilities that I can put in a journey that is relevant to this audience? And so I'll kind of end my sort of general answer with this. We've adopted six words, and those six words are our North Star for Bank of America, and they are designed for audiences, because you can't create content for every single person, designed for audiences, delivered to individuals. And that has become something that across the company now, everyone is footing to. At the same time, there's a lot of tech work going on, there's a lot of harnessing the data, and I think we're gonna be in a period of rapid prototyping, rapid experimentation as we move forward.
Jeff, how about yourself?
Yeah, I think, from the agency side, we approach it, obviously, a little bit differently in that we're trying to help our clients to understand and awaken to the value of data, and I think certain, clients of ours have, gotten there. They actually are using, DMP, they're onboarding their data and they're managing it correctly. But there's a lot of clients that, don't necessarily know how to do that. So we are, similar to other agencies, evolving to our practices and our expertise in building data management practices, data consultancy, and you're seeing a lot of other companies like, you know, Accenture getting to that business, and essentially that's sort of the new world of the consulting agency business. So, you know, we're really moving in that direction, and I think it's the smart move. You know, I think deterministic data, you know, targeting by device IDs, people-based marketing is the future. I do think that there are still a lot of other factors that's implicating this environment, in that the creative that we deliver in those channels aren't necessarily the best. I would say also that the inventory isn't necessarily the highest quality. You have issues with viewability and fraud, especially in the ad exchange world, where that type of inventory can be audience-based targeted. So there's a lot of and then the last part is measurement, right? So measurement across channels and across devices is a huge challenge. We talk a lot about people-based marketing, but what about people-based measurement? Are we looking at performance based on the individual? Did that individual actually convert and lead to a real business KPI, which is sales, right, or revenues in some kind of form, not necessarily engagement per se, or whether or not they actually view the ad? We need that person to actually do something, and we should be able to attribute, you know, what that person actually did offline or online. So really getting down to addressing all those challenges and helping our clients understand all the different places where they can maximize the value of their investment is essentially what we're focused on.
I love the people-based attribution component. That's the entire flip side of it. That's hopefully something we can come back to if we have time. Will, at Hearts and Science, AT&T, DirecTV, huge client, right? Television, it's a cookie-less world. How are you looking to, not even just on behalf of AT&T, DirecTV, and your other, and Hearts and Science's other clients, but how are you looking to meet consumers, their customers, their prospects in that cookie-less world?
I think that the my esteemed panelists have outlined some things that are pretty interesting, right? The first-party data from a client perspective is how you're going to win, right? Understanding who your audience is and what that can tell you about what your prospective audience would look like, and then finding interesting environments or where third-party data exists, so high-fidelity third-party data exists, to be able to utilize that to help find those prospective customers, right? And reach out in ways that form some sort of narrative for your customer is really key. In terms of actually finding those individuals, that's where things get sort of tricky, right? And that's where why the cookie has been the most, I'm going to use this word, but it's not a very persistent thing, but why it's been the most persistent targeting tool for us in the industry. The great news, though, is that the models that we're, you know, building out, whether it be fingerprinting or CRM, direct CRM match, or pub ID matches using CRM data, or another any other variety of that type of non-cookie based targeting, is resulting in us having a little bit more scale than we previously used to have. Right, this is not a new exercise. Right. We've all been in the industry for a little while. I'm sure everyone on this stage has tried to do a CRM match in 2011 and found nobody, right? So for us, what we really care about is trying to ensure that we are creating a platform of partners that enables our clients to have access to a variety of methods to get their high-quality data out to work for them so that we can have a better engagement with their customers or their prospective customers.
So we would agree that the industry is moving towards a more high-fidelity token to identify the consumer. To back into the path or the road to get there, where are we today in terms of...
I think it's moving in two directions, actually. I think there is an undercurrent of nonsense that is occurring that is using high-minded words to basically sound like it's cool and great and the next great thing, and then there's real deal high fidelity work that's being done, and I view it as my job as a representative of my clients and as a representative of my agency to parse out the nonsense from the high fidelity, or what I generally call the good actors. Because, right, there's high fidelity data, which, you know, Google's got high fidelity data for sure, right? But there's also good actors, right, that may have access to a methodology that enables us to shed light on our customer base in a way that isn't derivative of a large scale consumer base of their own, right? So I think there's multiple ways to go about it, but certainly for me, I think it's incumbent upon the advertisers and their representatives, whether that be agencies, consultancies, or whoever, to really dive into understanding who are the good actors in it, right? What is the methodology that people are using, not just, hey, high fidelity, you know, and falling into some buzzword that takes us down a weird path.
Sure, so it's not just the data in and of itself, it's how the data is, it's the method by which the data is leveraged.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, look, everybody, the cookie in and of itself is not a bad thing, right? There's a reason why it's existed for as long as it has, but the reason why, you know, third-party targeting has largely not been used in the way that it sort of promised was because of the way that the models were built around it, right? So if I can't think of how many times I've seen, the ability to look at what categories I'm placed in a third-party ad, and I'm both a male and a female. I'm, you know, earn under 30,000 and over 350,000, right? Like, I can't simultaneously.
You guys got a big bonus this last year.
Listen, this is all very exciting. Or they took it away from me horribly, and you know, but so I think it's not only what data we use, but how we use it, right? And having an open dialogue with our, you know, backstage, we were talking about the two levels of transparency, right? Mm-hmm. That there's commercial transparency, but that there's also sort of operational transparency. One of the operational transparencies is to have an open dialogue with your brand or with your agency or with your publisher or whatever, wherever you are in this buy flow, to have an open conversation about how data is being used to find the right customer.
Sure. And I wouldn't say we would propose, and I'd love to hear if you guys agree, it's that the cookie doesn't necessarily go extinct, but it is part of that rickety bridge to cross this chasm from, you know, where we are today in a desktop medium to moving to places where just the cookie doesn't exist, right? So, and again, the methodologies are important, and transparency about how those data points are leveraged, whether it be cookie, whether it be device ID, whether it be PII graph data. But I don't think there's any question that today, the cookie is the predominant token that is leveraged in media buying. Is that a fair statement? Like, how much of your investments are predicated by cookie density on a particular media company?
A lot, but thank goodness it's changing, right? Consumer behavior is changing, right? eMarketer came out with that thing, a year and a half ago, saying that the mobile phone was the most popular device by average consumer, you know, by average usage time by consumers. So to that point is, you know, you said it best in the opening salvo of this thing, which was, cookies done well for a long time on desktop, but consumer behavior is changing, right? We're just not using our desktop, our laptop in the same way that we were 5 years ago.
Just channel fragmentation.
So for me, like, when I look at it, you can't really consider a cookie in a connected TV, you know, environment. You can't really consider a cookie to a certain degree you can in a mobile phone environment, but like, why? 85% of the time is spent in app.
Right.
So, yeah.
I think there's three areas where clients need to lead in to help agencies. You know, I've been a client all my life. And I love agencies because you ask them for things and they actually go make them happen. That said, I think the clients owe the agencies a little bit more signal on where we need to go moving forward. And it shocks me when I find myself on panels like this, because invariably it's a bunch of really engaged folks from agencies or vendors. Very often you don't find, you know, clients that are up there like with their hair on fire about some issues. Like, there were three conversations I think clients need to lean in on. The first one is, what is our ROI model, right? We have built an ecosystem based on a return on this impression, right? I call that the transactional ROI model. Did this ad sell a product today? Some of us, like Bank of America, that are in a lifetime value business, we have 9 core products, some of which, like home loans and car loans, you come into and out of the market 7, 8, 9 times in your career, in your lifetime. Credit cards are there with you every day, checking and savings, you know, very frequently. For us, ROI is a return on relationship. For us, is being relevant over the course of the relationship. And so that affords us the ability to think about things other than ads. So we start to say, okay, maybe content that is really useful in a particular moment might be more important to the relationship than selling something. Maybe thinking about products as solutions instead of products is a whole different way to market. And so it's somewhat easier where I sit versus a fast-moving consumer good or some other clients to be able to get there. But I think in order to compete for attention, everyone's going to need to get to a relationship-based investment model, not a transaction-based investment model. Easier for some categories than others. I think the client needs to lean in on the hygiene issues. I think John, who I was on the transparency committee for the A&A, and we work closely with John as a representative from the 4As, you know, we need to be saying what is our minimum acceptable standard. And the wake-up call that the A&A gave us really should have you leaning into those conversations that maybe aren't so comfortable. I will tell you, when I started out in this business, I never thought that I would have, you know, be having conversations about quality of data and Hadoop data lakes and whatever as a part of my normal daily routine, but believe me, I do. So it's really leaning in and showing that you're not just comfortable outsourcing and giving really clear signal. You're just going to follow me around until I finish our conversation, right? And allowing the agency to say, no, this isn't satisfying the client, right? Because at the end of the day, the agency's under a lot of margin pressure. And if the client isn't screaming for it, maybe we don't need to solve it for the client. And so give clear signal about what's important to you. And I think the third thing, and this is really kind of probably too in the weeds, but we got to have the conversations about households versus people. If we're going to get really, really good at putting relevant content in front of Mrs. Consumer or Mr. Consumer, things like household addressable TV, which I'm particularly excited about, even though it's 1% of the total inventory out there today, you know, that's important. But how do we know? How do we use the device graph to figure out in a way that the consumer is comfortable? It's Mrs. Consumer sitting there because it's her mobile phone in the room versus Mr. That sounds creepy, but we've got to get there. We've got to get the value exchange right. So people say, I know if I provide this signal to marketers, they're going to create more relevant experiences for me. They're not going to inundate me with lowest common denominator crap, but they're actually going to give me news I can use. And so I think if the clients really lean in on those three things, the agency folks can say, okay, I know what I'm building. I know what the mandate is. Let me go solve that.
But doesn't that go, and that is a great point, and I want to open that to Jeff, because I think that brings it back to people-based attribution. But doesn't that, and it's not, this isn't to put a total bullet in the cookie, but to your point of moving away from household and getting, like, you know, I shouldn't be getting black and white market ads. Right, just my wife.
Well, we don't know what you do in your personal time.
Well, you know, the weekends, but you know, those should be for my wife. But doesn't that departure from the cookie? And again, not saying the cookie goes the way of the dodo bird, but moving into device ID graphs and CRM based PII addressable, doesn't that give you that level of fidelity to A, once you understand global reach and once you have global reach and frequency control across desktop display, your mobile device, your addressable TV set, your Alexa where you're doing voice advertising, in an application like Spotify, right, which the cookie doesn't live, doesn't that then allow folks like Jeff and Will to come back to you with a cleaner, I'm not saying it's perfect, but a cleaner attribution and therefore ROI model of where you should invest to reach individual consumers.
I think you know, you talk about how important measurement is, and I actually completely believe in that. And sometimes I go into meetings with certain clients and I say, you know, if you're looking at your campaigns based on cost, impression, clicks, or engagement, none of that stuff matters. Because at the end of the day, you have one specific business KPI, right? You know, whether it's generating sales or creating customer relationships. If I can't build a measurement framework to tell you how well your investment performed in that business KPI that you've decided, then everything I do is really completely useless. And we talk about all the different ways of getting closer with addressability, you know, using device ID targeting. All of those things is a way for us to intuitively think that we're getting closer to driving that business KPI. But are we even measuring it, right? Measurement isn't the fun part of what we do. It's not exciting, right? But it is probably the most important part. If we don't set that up correctly, I can't see how we can go back and say device ID is better than cookies, right? Because at the end of the day, does all of that matter? Viewability, does that all of that matter? If we get to the point where we can truly come to the holy grail of saying, you know, closed loop marketing is just something I'm very excited about. If we could say that we can attribute what we spent dollar by dollar to how well we performed in driving that KPI, all of those other things will fall in place, right? Viewability shouldn't be high. Because if it's high, if you got fraud that's very high, that shouldn't drive your business KPI. So it's almost like a pre-qualifier. If you focus on the right things to optimize against, all the other stuff becomes less and less important. So that's kind of my point of view on that.
I think that there is a certain degree of hygiene that is necessary in like building a KPI business result framework is incredibly important, and that's something that needs to be tailored to clients, right? Like, part of our industry has been trying to kill the click-through rate forever, but part of the challenge has been is that what does it get replaced with? And the answer is it sort of depends on what the client's business objectives or marketing goals are. But I think there's a context that's required around any of the media executions that we do with respect to hygiene. We do need to have a clean table to eat off of, And I think to that extent, I think that if you target a business objective, that things like fraud become less of a problem, or things like viewability become less of a problem. But we need to create environments that are as absent of that as we can make them, and then set loose our plans and our measurements, frameworks, and anything else that we do. I think one of the really interesting things about this addressability point, especially with high fidelity data, was I think it was a year ago, Facebook had that post on the results that they got when they were using their data in the open exchanges. And what they said was they had a ton of scale problems because there was an inventory fidelity problem. So to that extent, we need to create, so the solve for that, right, is then to create an environment where there isn't an inventory fidelity problem. So hygiene, I think, is really important as we incorporate these new tailored KPI frameworks.
I'm fist pumping here, but I think that the correlate to that is we need a currency that reflects the desired hygiene. So if the currency is attention, and we define attention in such a way that it's very clearly, you know, a human individual person that we're talking to that we can identify, then we're starting to put our money where our mouth is. As long as we still have a currency that is impression-based, you're still going to have the lack of hygiene, as you call it, in the system, and I think that's the exact right word.
Do you propose the currency moves from impression-based to people-based?
Yeah, 100%. I think Jonah Goodhart's got the hopefully this is not going to offend you. I think Jonah Goodhart's got the talk track from Moat.
Doesn't offend me at all.
You good with that?
He's a good man.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, I mean, it's like we need to say we want to transact based on the attention of real people and put our money where our mouth is. Along the lines of what John was talking about earlier about, you know, some of the walled garden issues, which are a huge problem for what we're talking about here, which I hope we can get into at some moment. We've got to put our dollars in a position where you have to reach for them in a way that comports with the vision of the future marketplace that we want.
Well, let's go there. So walled garden, screw the script. So walled garden, let's go there. Like, that's the existential, threat that we look at as an ecosystem. There are two major players that have addressability at scale, potentially soon to be a third, right? So, and there's an easy button pretty much attached to those two and now third player, right? That needs to happen across the rest of, and I'm using this loosely because there are other media brands outside of this number. That needs to happen within the Comscore 200. Plus, there are other great media brands that live outside the Comscore 200. So how do you move to a people-based currency, right, And look, we can call it the existential threats in the room. You know, Google and Facebook have an easy button against high fidelity addressable consumers. Snapchat probably soon to be the third, right? That's an existential threat to our entire ecosystem. How do we do that across the ComScore 200 plus
other great media brands that don't fall in that? When you say it's an existential threat to our ecosystem, what do you mean?
Here, I'll tell you. May I?
Go for it.
Okay, so if you're Mr. or Mrs. Consumer, and you are increasingly addicted to that feed, and obviously with 76% of our digital ad dollars going to Facebook or Google, we must believe that they are addicted, right? That thing is increasingly more personalized based on a set of high fidelity data that they have that's tailoring experiences from their friends, from their family, from the communities that they follow. And then you're there with this lowest common denominator ad that has got some level of targeting, but nowhere near as targeted as the rest of the content. So it starts to look like you showed up at the ball with tennis shoes and a tuxedo. Your ad is not going to compete for attention, and the thumb moves faster than the mouse, and it's going to go by. So if the world has moved to Facebook, and I lament that it may be true that they have, we need to have the same ability as Aunt Sally and her cat videos to break through and be relevant to Mrs. Consumer, who is a friend or a relation of Aunt Sally, and
not on Facebook. Who might not be on Facebook?
Right, exactly. So we're kind of fighting with, in my opinion, our arms tied behind our back because we're not being given access to the data we catalyze as marketers. We catalyze that data, right? So I'll stop my rant.
And I think that's definitely a threat for me because I think it shifts the power completely to the supplier. Right, because there's nowhere else that you could go. But I'm actually, happy to see that, maybe there is going to be more players out there. I actually think, the Verizon, AOL, and Yahoo could potentially be another player.
Absolutely.
And there will be more consolidation across the other 200, players out there.
But why are Verizon, AOL potentially a player? It's the data.
Correct.
It's the high fidelity addressable data.
Yeah, and I think that. Again, we're at a point in time where, there are certain players that are power players. But again, I go back to, at the end of the day, advertising is, the dollars are controlled by the marketers. And if marketers and agencies get together and start demanding and shift their spends to places where, we believe that there are companies out there and even consortiums that are trying to combine device IDs together to make it more powerful to compete with some of those folks. I imagine a world where, maybe there's a conversation one day between those power players and say, is it better industry-wide if we get together and begin to connect that data together, right? Because then that evens the playing field, which is what everyone else wants to do. But I do think that there's leverage. At the end of the day, the dollars are going to go where the marketers want it to go. So if we want to shift dollars away from those big players, it can happen. And we can make those demands of, look, we have to figure out a way to even that playing field with the other players out there, and there's leverage there.
I just want to say one thing on that. That point is so true. We were lost until we wrote our end state vision. Until we wrote a mission and vision about where we wanted to end up as a company in a one-to-one relationship business across all paid and owned touch points, and then we circulated that through my partners in technology who went, wow, that's pretty good. My partners in analytics were like, wow, that's pretty good. We all have this vague notion in our head of what better is, but I would say this year, maybe your February, whatever, New Year's resolution is, write an in-state vision where you want to be in 2 years or 3 years as a company. And actually start to talk about that with your agency and look at that as a living, breathing document. And it gives tremendous turn signal to people around you around where do you want to end up in this thing? Because until you do that, it's incremental. And I think you got to rip the Band-Aid off and really start in a fairly different direction than we're at now.
And, I think that's something that Hartz did that was to shamelessly plug myself.
I said Bank of America five times.
I'll try and make this the only one. I think the really cool thing that we've done is we've written a vision and a mission statement. And so when we have conversations about, hey, should we use ad network 1, 2, 3 that we have no operational or commercial transparency in, or should we use that because it gives us it's the easy button, right? I get results, I get the KPIs that my client wants right now, or should we think about how we create a more addressable environment for our advertisers to bring their CRM data into then because of our mission statement, that makes that conversation really easy. Mm-hmm. Hey guys, this is an on message here, right? And so that friction that exists in agencies, in between departments that have different incentives, it actually allows us all to move forward in lockstep in a way that's actually really refreshing. And I think regardless of whether you're a brand or an agency or even on the sell side of this, having a mission statement and standing for and making a position of not only where you are but where you're striving to, I think is really critical, because it'll enable all of us that say the same thing and strive for the same thing to work together, right? I mean, that's part of the reason why we partner with the people that we partner with, right? Is because we have a clear mission statement that they are on board with helping us get to.
Sure. Well, I also think incentives have to be aligned across the board, right? You know, we talked a little bit about how, you know, agencies are under a lot of pressure, and, you know, agencies are smart people. They're finding ways to drive that missing revenue from marketers reducing their fees. And sometimes the incentives are not necessarily aligned, right? You got agencies trying to figure out how to make money out of this process. And you know, with Assembly, we take a purely transparent approach because we believe that's sort of the future. And if your incentives are not aligned, I think that causes a ton of problems, because the agencies are making so much profit margin in many ways that there's no incentive to bring clarity and transparency into this picture. Until somebody points the finger like the ANA and says, by the way, you guys are doing something that's a little bit not ethical, right? So I think that incentives have to be aligned eventually, and I think as long as it's not, we're going to progress a little bit slower. You know, there's going to be a little bit of a hidden margin kind of conversation where it's a conversation that we don't want to have. But at some point, I think marketers get smarter about where the monies are going. I consider this, what's happening now in the industry is almost like a bad drug deal, right? Everybody's stepping on it. Everyone's got to grab, you know, a piece of that pie. And at some point, we got to come clean and say, look, let's get rid of all of that stuff, you know, the little nonsense that's going on and people gaming the system in order to create fraud and viewability issues. That all hopefully will kind of disappear eventually, so that we can focus on, you know, figuring out the right technology, the right measurement framework to actually do some great work.
You touched on a lot of good things there. We talked about hygiene. We've talked about methodologies. We've talked about fraud. Isn't part of this a GEICO issue? And I'll bring it back to the cookie and moving away from that. You know, when you've got something that has a, depending on the study you read, anywhere between a 20 and 40% churn rate, don't you have a hygiene challenge out of the gate? Wouldn't things like, if you had a truly addressable consumer, wouldn't that have mitigated things like MethBot? You know, again, sure. And then just, again, where consumers are going. They're going to cookie-less world. So, like, what are your strategies, or do you have strategies in place? It sounds like, you know, you've got a mission statement at Hearts and Science, right? How does addressability, it may not be in your mission statement, but how does that factor in?
I mean, it is our mission statement.
It is your mission statement.
It is our mission statement.
Awesome. So how does addressability factor into that?
I mean, it's first of all, it's our mission statement. So that's the whole game for us is we believe that the data that our brands have, it will help them win, right? It'll help them have better conversations with their consumers, have better conversations with all consumers, and create content, whether that be an ad or not an ad, in a way that enables them to participate and fight for the attention in a way that is differentiated. So that's the whole game for us.
So there's a mission there. Like
that,
you guys
that's the whole game, right? That's why we're partnering with our sister agencies on creative, because we believe that we need to bring not only the addressability from a targeting and measurement and KPI development standpoint, but also to the content creators that are responsible for building the messaging. That's our whole game. Point about the cookie and whether that gets us into these issues or not. Well, I would contend that yeah. Part of it, but it's sort of a two-pronged thing, right? You've got a data problem and you've got an inventory problem.
We talked about this.
Is a huge component. Is like, yes, we can get the data cleaned up. We've got high fidelity data. We can, create device graphs and data lakes and all sorts of other apparatuses to develop this data in a way that enables us to go target it, but where do we actually target? And that's where having relationships with publishers on a more direct basis and holding people in that that supply chain accountable for making sure that we know that this pub is who they say they are, that they are, that they create great content for their consumers, and we want our brands to be associated with that. That, to me, is critical to this whole thing of activating you know, high fidelity data and making it a more addressable world.
Yeah, so if I were to paraphrase, if there were a platform out there where you could have a direct audience transaction with a publisher using your data, that would be kind of the...
Somebody should build that.
Yeah, I wonder who that should be. I digress. Jeff, what about yourself? How does addressability factor into your strategy? What are your... Are you guarded for it? Do you have plans for it? Are you actively prepared for it?
Yeah, I mean, for us, it's we take a very similar approach in ensuring that we're media neutral, right? You know, we want to actually find audiences where they are. But I think that it's actually we put an emphasis on the actual delivery vehicle of that message, right? Because it's so important where if we're building a creative that, you know, reacts to the person that we're targeting, that's much more effective ultimately. So I think that we really focus on, you know, ensuring that the right messages get sent over, and that you talk a lot about, you know, finding all the different channels, but it's beyond that. It's every little thing from setting up the right measurement metrics. It's setting up, you know, onboarding the DMP. In my opinion, is a big part of it. You know, clients are sometimes they're not aware of the importance of that. And, you know, it's doing that, you know, helping them with their data management capability, finding the right messages to deliver, using the right data and technology that exists currently, and prepping them for things that are going to be future-proof later on. So I think it's all those things combined, and also being transparent. You know, most of all, I think we've gotten a little away from, you know, really being true consultants for our clients, especially during, you know, the age of programmatic when everything was bought through an ad exchange. And I think that's kind of taken away, you know, we focus a little bit too much on profitability sometimes. So I think, you know, going back to being transparent, for me at least, at Assembly has been refreshing in that we're capable of just being consultants and making the right moves. And that allows us to essentially recommend and become truly media neutral. We're not pushing for things that, you know, doesn't make sense, or it might be better for us. We're not capturing or playing with data and then reselling it to our other clients for our own profitability reasons. So I think being transparent for us is something that we value, and I think our clients also value that too.
Yeah, for me, it's a little bit different. You know, I see from a third-party perspective the value of that cookie waning. But, you know, bankofamerica.com is a top 20 website in terms of traffic.
Mm-hmm.
I have a pervasive first-party cookie that lives in iOS for a long time. I know my people often, if they're already customers of the bank, and in many cases, I have permission to market them in a certain context. So for me, that cookie has tremendous value and will continue to be the basis of a signal set that I use to curate experience, right? So, mm-hmm. So I have that. Beyond that, you know, and I've learned this from working with my colleagues in the what we call the on-us environment, which is people on our app or on our website, there are basically three classes of people that you deal with. People that you think you know, people that you think you know something about, and people that you absolutely don't know, that you've never seen before, or on a device that you've never seen before. And in that world, which is the old world from whence we come, more so than the world I think we're all rushing to, you are still going to look for any kind of signal to try to think, what would I do with the messaging space in first-party environments, but also the principle applies in third-party environments. If I had the opportunity through a sponsorship or a fixed position or something, what's the best bet to put in front of that person? So I think cookies are always going to exist, you know, like I think you can still send a telegram. No offense if anybody here is Western Union. It's always going to exist in some way. We're not going to throw it out. I'm more excited about what the first-party cookie unlocks with me, particularly when I'm in matches with, you know, some of the vendor community who have the high-fidelity data. So I'm kind of, I don't think the cookie's going away. I think the use case is going to be a first-party cookie helping me to really find my customers, and then
third-party cookies for signals that might be, you know, I can build a case for what I want to put in front of that person.
What about, and we'll leave you to answer this last question, then we'll open it up to the folks. You value that first-party cookie because it's a Bank of America minted cookie,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And because it's first-party, less churn, higher fidelity.
Yeah, much.
You also have very rich touch points directly with your customers. What about things like CRM data match? With publishers.
Yeah. No, we are actively pursuing that. You know, internally, we're in an enormous effort to build a really, I think, world-class personalization engine that leverages all of our data and vendor data. And that conversation started 3.5 years ago with, you know, somebody saying, now, what is a DMP again? And now we're at a point where we're really talking about how are we going to build, you know, differentiated world-class experiences that leverage every bit of data across every touch point. And I spend more of my time with the head of analytics and the person who runs tech marketing than I do with the vendor community anymore. And for most of you who know me, you know, it's a strange thing to spend 6 hours of your day with whiteboards and on, you know, WebExes, talking about how the map works, talking about who the vendors are that we're RFPing, talking about how we're building it. So we're in a massive transition that I think when it's over, we are going to have a very good orchestration model that is going to be able to do personalization at tremendous scale.
Right. So last question for you, Lou, and then we'll open it up. And some more for the pubs in the room. Does your investment thesis or how you look at investing in media against that high fidelity segment, whether it be Bank of America first party cookie, CRM data match, is that, are you willing to pay more? Because you know.
100%. I've even gone so far as to talk to some of the platforms about saying maybe we should have a secondary business, which is data licensing. And maybe there's X and Y. Let's get real about this. The data is going to be more important, right, than the advertising performance. Because the advertising performance, in my opinion, is going to continue to diminish. I think what's going to start performing more effectively, content, utility, experiences that are tailored, right? The ongoing model. So let's figure out what I have to do to license the data from some of these walled gardens. I think that's a fair conversation, because when you talk to the heads of these platforms, they're all like, well, if I give it to you, how do I know you're going to keep advertising on me? And that's a valid concern, mm-hmm. right? Because I could port it into my DMP and I could let it just age there over time. And so I think we need to, you know, cross that bridge. Let's look at the data value of that. I have no idea how that should be priced. But let's create an ecosystem we can win in versus we can lose less in. You know, that's.
But even that media execution, you're willing to pay more for that media against
absolutely.
That addressable consumer.
Absolutely. I mean, we are. We have an ongoing bar that moves every year in terms of the quality of data. We have 5 different categories that we have a bar, and we just went through that meeting 2 weeks ago. And you know, there's like, I want to say of the 200 top, maybe 56 meet all 5. So they're our first stop.
Got it.
And then we go from there.
There you go, pubs. You heard it. They'll pay more if it's an addressable consumer. With that, we have about 2 minutes. We'd love to open it up to the.
But Tony, that's an important thing that addressability is defined by the brand.
Of course.
So that's an important thing to mention here. Is that it is not a pub defined consumer. It is a brand defined consumer.
I would counter that with 98% of our entire industry is defined by the brand.
Yeah. Yeah, but we haven't been strong enough about saying we want a single view of the customer across all touch points. We can't take your flavor of vanilla with their flavor of vanilla. That's the Facebook-Google problem,
because
I can't match the vanillas then. You know,
right. There needs to be a standard around it.
Yeah.
All right, with that, thank you, Lou. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Will. I appreciate everyone's time. I hope this was engaging. Enjoy the rest of the conference.